Good evening, I'm David Brown, and welcome to the Northern Sun Experience. For the past couple of seasons, no rivalry in NSIC men's basketball has been more intense than MSU Moorhead and Augustana. Two nationally ranked teams over the past few years, the Vikings have gotten the better of the Dragons in each of the last five get-togethers. That includes two consecutive victories in the NSIC Tournament Championship, and the rivalry was renewed in a big way on Friday night as Augustana welcomed MSUM to Sioux Falls Arena. Vikings up 22-21 in the first half, but that changes in a hurry. The Dragons, Ayoub knocks down the three. He would have a big game for the Dragons. Now tied at 26, Tanner Kretschmann's pass is intercepted by John Warren, who coasts in for the slam. We would be tied at 32 at halftime. Late second half, tied at 61, Augie's Jordan Spencer drives towards the middle and somehow, someway gets the reverse layup to go for his first points of the ball game. Back at the other end, it's Abe with the short hook in the lane. We would go to overtime, tied at 65. In the extra frame, Dragons up three with less than a minute to go. Spencer finds Marcus Osmus for the hoop plus the foul. Osmus had a career-high 26. We're tied at 76. Next MSUM possession, Johnny Beninga drives inside, gets the scoop layup to go with 5 seconds left. But Augustana heads right back the other way, and Adam Beyer hits the reverse layup with 0.4 seconds remaining. We head to double overtime, tied at 78. Now 89-89 with 3.7 seconds left, and the Dragons finally break through. Matt Nelson finds Ayoub on a backdoor cut for the game-winning layup with 2.4 seconds left. Ayoub had a career-high 28 points, and MSU Moorhead finally slays Augustana 91-89 in double overtime. Earlier Friday, the MSU Moorhead women hoping to win their 14th straight game as they battled Augustana. Vikings up 6-4 in the first when Drew Sanis nails the straightaway three. She came into this game as a top five scorer and rebounder in the conference. A little later in the first, still 7-6 MSUM, when Lindsay Prosser finds a trailing Shelby Sellen for three, and Augustana retakes the lead. Second quarter now, Dragons up 23-21 and adding to it. Jessica Hart, the former South Dakota State player with the high arcing corner three. MSUM ended the first half on a 7-0 run. Third quarter, Dragons continuing to be in the right place at the right time. Off the missed three, Sanis is right there for the putback to make it 30-23 MSUM. Augustana trying to hang with the NSIC leaders. Prosser nails her second straight three-pointer and cuts the lead to 41-35. But that's as close as the Vikings would get. In the fourth, Sanis nails another triple. That makes it 53-41. Sanis had 26 points, 10 rebounds, and 3 blocks. As MSU Moorhead tops Augustana 65-55, the Dragons also won at Wayne State the following night, making it 15 straight victories for MSUM. And when we come back, we'll talk about that 15-game winning streak with our basketball analyst, Jordan Dalton.
The Northern Sun Experience on Midco Sports Network is presented by Sanford Orthopedics and Sports Medicine and Dakota Land Honda.
And welcome back to the Northern Sun Experience. We're by former Augustana point guard Jordan Dalton to break down all things NSIC hoops. We're going to start with the women this time. And Jordan, MSU Moorhead still undefeated in conference play, 12-0, 15-1 overall. And they lost their first game, so it's a 15-game winning streak overall. Last week we talked about how Drew Sanis was playing well, but who else is stepping up for the Dragons?
Yeah, I think when you look at the Dragons on the offensive end, you also have to look at Cassidy Thorson. I mean, she's just been an absolutely phenomenal weapon on the perimeter. You know, she's shooting almost 40% from the three-point line, and she's a player who really understands her strengths. She understands that I think over 60% of her made field goals have come from the three-point line. So she understands who she is, but she's a tremendous weapon out there on the perimeter. I also think her teammates do a great job of finding her and constantly looking for her on the offensive end. They set great screens to get her open. And obviously just having that type of weapon really opens up everything when it comes to the painted area too, because teams understand that they can't leave Thorson open. They have to stick with her, so it makes some defensive rotations a little bit more difficult as well. And so that combination of, again, them just having great understanding of the strengths of their team on the offensive end obviously has resulted in great success with the 15-game winning streak.
And the Dragons seem to have a set rotation. They got a lot of freshmen playing off the bench, and girls like Megan Hinson and Shannon Gallagher doing really well for MSU Moorhead. Well, in the South Division, the co-leader is still Sioux Falls. Two close games, but two road victories. They have the conference's top defense, but offensively, they're kind of a middle-of-the-pack team. Seems to statistically. Is that a testament to their defense, or can USF's offense pick it up?
Well, we talked about it in the past. Cougars have been known as far as a high up-tempo, high-paced scoring team, where this year their calling card has been defense. But I do think on the offensive end, you want to continue to get better as the season progresses. We talked about the great point guard play of Maddie Robson. She does a great job of getting others involved, but I think the Warriors really struggle when they have to score on their own, when they have to go out, create their own shots. And so basically one of the only players that can do that on the Cougar squad is Brooke Smith. And so once you get outside of her, they really have some issues creating offense on their own. Now this past weekend, obviously senior Sam Connect had a great weekend, ended up getting South Division Player of the Year, averaging 19 and a half points and 9 boards a game for the weekend. And so you think if they can establish her a little bit more in the post and the painted area, maybe that opens up some things on the perimeter, helps get some cleaner looks. But I think as the season continues, they want to obviously continue to progress on the offensive end.
As I mentioned, the top defense, they're 9th statistically in points per game offensively, but USF will have 4 straight games at home coming up in the next 2 weekends. Well, the other co-leader in the South Division is Winona State. The Warriors have won 6 of their last 7, and that one loss was by only 1 point to USF. So what's working so well for the Winona State Warriors?
Well, the Warriors are just absolutely phenomenal on the defensive end. You know, they haven't let one opponent score over 70 points this entire season. And so that is absolutely their calling card and their staple, and obviously has resulted in a tremendous amount of success. And I think what they do best is they guard from the inside out, and meaning that they protect the painted area. You know, you're not getting any clean looks or easy layups or mid-range jump shots in the painted area. And so that really, really frustrates a lot of teams, because obviously we always talk about on the offensive end, you kind of want to work from inside out, whether that's getting good post touches or penetration. Well, the Warriors, they shut down everything in the painted area. And so it forces teams out on the perimeter to take some contested jump shots or just lower percentage jump shots. And so I think with that type of intensity, that's obviously a recipe for success, because you're going to have nights when you don't shoot the ball well. That's just going to happen. But what you can have every single night is energy and effort on the defensive end. And obviously the Warriors have brought that on a consistent basis.
And like Sioux Falls, as well as the co-division leader, they also have 4 straight games coming up in Winona. Well, what's a women's team that's a little bit under the radar that's doing pretty well right now that maybe no one's really talking about?
Yeah, I think if you look at Minnesota Duluth, they're a team that's kind of, you know, it's a log jam in the middle of the conference. And they're a team in the next 2 weeks that I think can really, really make some headway. You know, 3 of their next 4 games are against Minnesota State, Moorhead, Northern State, Augustana, and then their 4th game is against Wayne State. And so they have a lot of opportunities to really create some separation in the next 2 weeks. Now, in order to do that, the Duluth Bulldogs are going to have to do a much better job at shooting the basketball. Right now, they're only shooting 40% from the field, and that's just not going to get it done on a consistent basis. So I think if they can find some ways to get out in transition, get to the free throw line, just get easier possessions and easier points on the board, that's really going to play a long way. But these next 2 weeks are 2 weeks that can really determine the rest of their season. You know, that can make them feel like, all right, we're in the top upper echelon of the conference, or they can really take a step back. So I'm guessing they'll be locked in and engaged these next couple of weeks.
Absolutely. Some very tough matchups ahead for the Bulldogs. Well, we've discuss the MSU Moorhead women, but the men are also leading the way in the NSIC. Jordan's going to break down their big weekend when we come back. And welcome back to the Northern Sun Experience. Once again, joined by Jordan Dalton. Jordan, we're going to talk about MSU Moorhead on the men's side. Best record overall and best record in the conference. 2 big road wins this weekend, including a double overtime victory at Augustana. You were in the crowd at that game. The Dragons had lost 5 straight to the Vikings. So can getting the monkey off the back be a bit of a momentum builder for the rest of the season?
Absolutely. Like you said, one of the best games I've seen in a really long time. And I thought that game just spoke to the mental toughness of the Dragons. You know, like I said, double overtime, hard-fought battle the entire game, and they just stuck with it. And over the last 2.5 seasons, Augustana has really had the Dragons' number when it comes to playing basketball, obviously, in the conference. And so just to get a win, not only a win, but a win on Augie's home court, I think that can do a tremendous amount for your confidence moving forward, because you know you can go anywhere and beat any team on any given night. And so you have that confidence every time you step on the court. What I thought was actually equally as impressive was coming back Saturday night less than 24 hours later and beating Wayne State too, because they had three guys that played more than 45 minutes on Friday night. And so that just is it's a drain. It took a lot of energy. It was a very physical, hard fought game on Friday night. So for the Dragons to bounce back and take care of business Saturday night, I thought that spoke volumes about their team's character and the fact that they weren't satisfied with just getting the win on Friday night. They have bigger and larger goals ahead of them. And so I thought, again, I was more impressed almost by Saturday night than I was by Friday night.
Everyone, of course, always talks about Aaron Lean and Tanner Crutchman on MSU Moorhead, but it was Ayub who had the game-winning basket and a career-high 28 points against Augustana. Meanwhile, for the Vikings, it was another close, tough loss at home. That was their third straight loss at home. They did follow it up with a good win against Northern State. None of those three home losses were blowouts. They were in contention throughout. So even with that win over Northern State, how does Augie sort of get over that hump of closing things out in the final minute?
Yeah, we just talked about it. You know, with their last three losses, they're a handful of plays away from winning those games. And so I don't think there needs to be any grand wholesale changes on the team. But I think what they're starting to understand is every possession matters. And so you have to come out and be locked in and engaged for 40 minutes on every single possession. You know, when you look at something easy that they can correct, the free throw line. You know, Friday night, double overtime loss, you shoot 60% from the free throw line. And a lot of those misses were on front ends of one and ones. And so you're really just giving away points there. And again, that's just a process or a product of not being locked in and engaged, because, you know, they have great shooters, obviously. So when you get to the line, you got to take advantage of that. And then we talked about in the past, Mike Musak and Jordan Spencer are absolute studs, and they're going to come to play every night. But when one of those two have an off night, Augie just doesn't seem to have the offensive firepower to overcome that. We talked about, you know, Jordan Spencer just not shooting the ball very well Friday night. And they're going to have games like that. So they have to consistently find other guys that can step in a scoring role and, like I said, do it on a consistent basis. Stephen Schaefer has been great off the bench this year, really able to shoot the ball from the perimeter. But it was fun to see Marcus Austin. He had a great
career
game.
High.
Exactly. You know, 26 points, 10 boards. And you could just see the confidence that gave him. And so hopefully as guys continue to step up, you're going to need, you know, your Marcus Osmonds, you're going to need Zach Huskin, you're going to need John Warren, you're going to need all these guys to really step up and play big roles, because inevitably you're going to have nights where Spencer or Busek just don't have it going.
You mentioned how valuable the possessions are. In all three of Augustana's home losses over the past few weeks, they have been tied with under 30 seconds to go either in regulation or in overtime. Well, Augie's counterpart, the University of Sioux Falls, got two road wins over Bemidji State and Minnesota Crookston. Cougars have now won six games in a row. That's a program record in the D2 era. So who's playing well specifically for USF?
Yeah, I think they have two guys that are absolute matchup problems for everybody, and Drew Gubert and Daniel Hurt. You know, those are big physical guys that can really take anybody in the post. Goober's obviously a little bit taller, you know, uses his length, and Hurt has a lot of girth about him and can really throw his body around in the post. So you can't really play them with smaller guards, but if you put bigs on them, both of them are shooting over 35% from the three-point line as well. And so it's a matchup nightmare for most teams, because how do you defend them? Again, like you said, if you put guards on them, they're going in the post, they're very skilled over both shoulders and can really get easy buckets there. But if you put bigs on them, they're running around the perimeter, coming off screens where most bigs just aren't comfortable out there. And so I think the combination of those two have really created a lot of matchup problems and allowed them to have some great success this year.
And USF a chance to get to double digits at 10 wins. They got four straight at home coming up in the next 2 weeks. Well, just like on the women's side, what's a men's team that's a bit under the radar that's doing really well right now?
Well, we talked about it. Obviously, Northern State Wolves, they lost Saturday night in a tough game against Augustana. The game was a lot closer than the final score indicated, but I think they have a great shot to really create some separation over the next 2 weeks as well. You know, you look at Northern State, they're sitting at 8-4 in the conference. You know, there's three or four teams basically in their same position. Again, three of their next four games are against St. Cloud, University of Sioux Falls, and then Southwest Minnesota State. And so they have three great games, three great opportunities to really show that they can come out and compete with anybody in the conference.
Absolutely. Logan Doyle doing well for them, along with DJ Pollard and Mac Arvidsson. Well, Jordan Dalton, thank you very much.
Absolutely.
When we come back, our Under the Northern Sun Campus alumni feature showcases MSU Moorhead. Welcome back. Considering we're right in the middle of hoop season, it's only appropriate the next two members of the NSIC's 25th anniversary team left it all out on the court. Congrats to former Northern State hoopster Julie Jensen. Already an NSIC Hall of Famer, Jensen excelled during her junior season in Aberdeen when she made the All-Conference First Team, All-Region First Team, and led the Wolves to the 1994 NAIA National Championship. Jensen is currently a physical education teacher in Redfield, South Dakota. And congrats to former Winona State basketball standout Jonte Flowers. A defensive wizard, Flowers was a four-time NSIC Defensive Player of the Year, set the NCAA record for career steals, and helped the Warriors to two national championships. Flowers' career has blossomed overseas since graduating from Winona State, where he's played in Sweden, France, Finland, Romania, and currently in Italy. Well, all season long, we've been showcasing distinguished alumni from every NSIC school in our Under the Northern Sun features. But this week's alum might be the most knowledgeable man on the entire conference. Longtime MSU Moorhead Sports Information Director Larry Scott, affectionately known as Scotty, reflects on where the Dragons have been and where they're heading.
The Northern Sun Intercollegiate Conference turns 25 this season. Who better from MSUM to recap the Dragons' role in the history of the league than the man who was there through it all, NSIC and MSUM Hall of Famer, Larry Scott.
When I started at MSU Moorhead, it was just the NIC, and it was a six-team affair. It was a very competitive league, but curiously, you know, very small in that. And that was really before the women's program took full blossom. And then they operated with the Northern Sun on the women's side for a while. And ultimately, the officials made the right decision to merge the two leagues together. But at one time, we had separate conferences, men or women, and that wasn't very productive, and I don't think it was very fair. But by putting it together, certainly strengthened the bond. It made the league a lot better, and I think it increased the quality of play.
Fast forward 25 years later, the NSIC has become a power in the national landscape of college athletics, according to Scotty.
Most of us remain convinced that it is the best Division II league in America. It was always a good league, but there were others, including the late North Central Conference, that might have been a little bit better. But I don't think there's any league overall that's better. And clearly in some sports, volleyball comes to mind. There's no league in America that even comes close to matching our conference. So I think our league can take a great deal of pride in overall competition, the balance between the genders, and certainly in all the sports. The NSIC, big footprint now, not just in the Midwest anymore, but all across the country.
Through all of that time, Scotty roamed the sidelines, sat courtside, and roamed the halls of Nemzik. So what are a few of the many names of MSUM's NSIC past that stand out to him?
Well, I go back, you know, a little further than that, and so there were some that were pretty memorable early on, particularly in football. College wrestling was big, but there are a few that stand out. I look at a guy like Brett Beeson, who was the player of the year in Division II basketball, a great scorer, tremendous player for the Dragons in the 90s. Nate Hendrickson came along a couple years later and was a Division II wrestler of the year in the country. We were particularly proud of them. There were others like Katie Klass, who was competed in track and cross country at MSUM. She also made the Olympics in speed skating. And then today there's just a raft of quality players on a variety of levels, and there's so many of them. I'm almost a little leery for omitting names, but certainly I think MSU Moorhead, along with other teams in the league, have every right to feel good, and there are a lot of people that have come through these programs and distinguished themselves.
Finally, what's in store for the future of the NSIC to someone who's been there every boot step of the way?
A lot of leagues don't stay constant forever, we know that, so there could be some changes in membership in that. I don't see it for a while, and I think there's a very good feeling, a commitment, kind of common resolve within the league, which I like. I think people certainly have a lot of respect and admiration for each other, so I think we're on good footing in the NSIC. I know we are, and I'm optimistic in the future. I know there'll be issues, there'll be challenges, but I think we have the right people in place to meet them.
When we come back, it's DB's Picks, the top plays of the past week.
The Northern Sun Experience on Midco Sports Network is presented by Sanford Orthopedics and Sports Medicine and Dakota Land Honda.
Welcome back. For the second straight week, it's a supersized edition of DB's Picks, my top seven plays of the past week. At number seven, Doyle Rules. After the defense collapses on Beau Freeze, he finds Logan Doyle for the two-handed flush against Wayne State. The transfer from SDSU has established himself as one of the best big men in the entire conference, averaging more than 14 points and nearly 9 rebounds a game. But it's his two-handed throwdown that gets him on the countdown at number seven. For number six, it's the first of several buzzer beaters on our list. Off the miss, Minnesota State's Sammy Delzato goes coast to coast and hits the floater at the end of the third quarter. After a five-game losing streak, the Maverick women got back on track with a sweep of the North Dakota teams at home this weekend, punctuated by clutch plays like Delzato's at number six. We stay in Mankato for our fifth best play of the week, this time from the men. Cole Harper leads the Mavs in transition against Umeri, then drops it off to John Fuqua for the slam. Take another look, Harper goes flying down the court off the rebound, and Fuqua caps off the fast break with the fifth best play of the past week. At number four, we head to St. Cloud, where Gage Davis engages the defender, then drives right past him for the hammer. Check it out one more time. Davis fakes the three to get his defender in the air, then glides in for the flush. The NSIC's leading scorer soars at number four. For number three, we go back to Mankato and another Fuqua throwdown. On the break, this time it's Joey Wittes with a pass and Fuqua slamming it home on the alley-oop. Fuqua's had four dunks in my top plays over the past few weeks, but unquite like this alley-oop at number three. At number two, Augustana's Adam Beyer forces a second overtime. After MSU Moorhead's Johnny Beninga hits the layup with 5 seconds left, Beyer takes the inbounds and goes all the way to the rack for the reverse layup with 0.4 seconds remaining. The senior provided some great leadership and gave the Vikings a chance in double OT, thanks to play number two. But our number one play of the week ended those Viking chances. Tied with 3.7 seconds left and 2 seconds on the shot clock, MSU Moorhead's Ayub finds himself wide open on the backdoor cut for the game-winning layup. Great execution on the play design, and Matt Nelson fired a perfect pass to Ayub for the double overtime win and the number one play of the past week. Once again, a thank you to all of our NSIC member schools. Tune in next week for an all-new Northern Sun experience.